Thank you. Casey Paul Griffiths comes to us most recently by way of the church office building, where he is currently employed in the church educational system, the Seminaries and Institutes program, as a curriculum writer. Prior to working in the curriculum team up in Salt Lake, he taught seminary in Salt Lake and Utah Valleys at Mountain View High School, Alta High School, and Jordan at the Jordan Seminary. Also, he's also taught institute classes in the Sandy, Joram, and Orem Institutes of Religion. He's been teaching for us for a number of semesters. I believe he's taught for us 3 semesters here on campus. Also, by way of education, did his undergraduate degree here at the Y. Also, his master's degree in our Urban Leadership and Foundations, where he wrote a dissertation on the globalization of Latter-day Saint education. Some of you have read Casey's writings, a number of which are posted on the shared drive, together with his Vita and cover letter and other things. We invite you to review those. His publications have he's been published in BYU Studies, The Religious Educator, Mormon Historical Studies, a forthcoming article there, and also the Journal of Mormon History, the most recent issue of the Journal of Mormon History. I brought it in for you to see. This one came out, I guess, about a week ago. And Casey has a nice article in here on the church's Chilean school system. He continues to research and write on educational history topics, and we're excited to hear his presentation this morning. You and your wife live in
Saratoga
Springs, and they have 3 children. So just biographically, that's where he is and what he does. And we will turn the time over to Casey. As we've discussed, I think Casey will make a presentation of roughly 25, 30 minutes, something like that, and then leave the remainder of the time for questions, both about his presentation and also just questions you may have getting to know him better personally, his research interests, his teaching background, his expertise, and his desires to come to BYU. So here's our opportunity to get to know Casey better, and we're grateful to have him with us, and turn the time over to you. Thank you.
It's good to be here. My wife asked me if I was nervous last night, and I said, on the surface, I'm totally calm. Underneath, I'm just a little girl. It's really scary. And this is probably the part of the day that's most nerve-wracking for me, because I'm familiar with your work as scholars and appreciate what you've done, and have been inspired a lot by the work that you've carried out. When it comes to my research interests, there's a lot of stuff that I'm interested in. I wrote my master's thesis on Joseph F. Maryland's work in church education. My doctoral dissertation was on the globalization of Latter-day Saint education, which focused on the spread of seminaries and institutes around the world. In fact, I built off a foundation of a great scholar from this department, Dale LeBaron, whose work we discovered almost in an Indiana Jones-ish type way up in the church office building, was about to be thrown away. And I found these papers that he had done starting on this project where he had gone out and basically interviewed all of the American teachers that were sent out in the 60s and 70s to start seminaries and institutes. My project was to then find the indigenous teachers that were recruited by these American teachers and compile a database or a collection of interviews for them. Some of the interviews were already existing in the Church History Library. Some of them I tracked down and did myself. Some of them I Skyped with. Some of them I called in their home countries. A surprising number of these indigenous teachers live in St. George, so I spent a lot of time down there talking with and dealing with them. So my work has been primarily in the 20th century, but when I've talked to Richard, he's told me just to talk about what I'm excited about right now and what I'm working on. So what I was working on at the moment when I found out that I was going to come down here and present is right now I'm working on a biography of Joseph F. Merrill for the University of Utah. And one of the wonderful things about Merrill is there is a rich, rich amount of source material. There's 42 boxes in his papers over in the Lee Library that's completely open for anybody to study. There's 5 more boxes up at the Church History Library. There is 10 or 12 boxes up at the U, and then scattered in repositories throughout the Intermountain West. There's a lot of other things. I've even heard rumors, and I'm trying to save up the money to go back to Harvard. There's supposed to be some collector's items there. But let me focus on a little bit what I'm talking about. One of the reasons why I picked Joseph Merrill is because he straddles the era where Mormonism goes from being kind of this insular intermountain faith that is very much based around and accepts the idea of plural marriage to what it is today in a modern sense. He's born in 1868 in Richmond, Utah. His dad is Mariner Merrill, who later on becomes an apostle, has 8 wives. Joseph is the first son of the 4th wife. And by the end of his life, he's basically living in the modern church. President McKay is the last president of the church that he serves under as an apostle. And his writings really give kind of a nice insight into the mindset, first of all, of young Mormons as we transition between these two eras. Not only that, the development of a great intellectual within the church. Joseph Merrill was a highly respected scientist, a physicist, before he was called into the Quorum of the Twelve. And not only that, he was one of the first young Latter-day Saints to travel east. Some documents place him as the first PhD from Utah, first native Utahan to earn a PhD. And one of the most rich areas of source material comes from these letters that exist between Joseph Merrill and his fiancée. Her name was Laura Hyde. Annie Laura Hyde. He's the son of an apostle, Mariner Merrill, who's called in 1889. She is the granddaughter of two apostles, Orson Hyde, where her last name comes from, and John Taylor. And both of them have experienced plural marriage in their own ways. Joseph's family was very open about it. His dad was one of the most well-known polygamists within the Utah Territory. She, on the other hand, is urban. She comes from Salt Lake City, and she experiences polygamy on a totally different level. Her father did take a plural wife, but after the Edmunds Tucker Act had been passed, and did it secretly. And according to the Salt Lake newspaper accounts, she was even called to testify in court as to whether or not her father had taken a second wife. So both of them have experienced this and are wrestling with it. They're both really intellectual. They meet at the University of Deseret. And after a few years there, Joseph is recruited by his uncle, Joseph Kingsbury, who later on is going to become president of the University of Utah, to travel east to get a doctorate in chemistry so that he can come back and basically start the School of Chemistry at the U of U. Now, the correspondence that exists between them is voluminous. There's over three boxes and hundreds of letters back and forth. And as you would expect in the letters, they cover a lot of topics relating to what was going on in Utah in the 1890s. So Joseph is back east. He's splitting his time between Baltimore, where he's studying at Johns Hopkins, and Chicago. He spent his summers at the University of Chicago studying. And their correspondence sort of not only gives a lot of insight into their personalities, but also to some of the issues that young Latter-day Saints were dealing with. So these are two Latter-day Saints in their 20s. The manifesto has been issued 4 or 5 years previous to this, and what they write back and forth to each other kind of gives us a window into this rising generation and how they were grappling with some of the issues. In fact, as you read some of this, it was amazing to me how much it parallels some of the things that the students that we teach today are grappling with. Just to give you a sample of their personalities, Joseph is probably the more old-fashioned of the two. He writes her and says, "I could easily think of a leopard changing spots as if you're developing into a woman who would delight to revel in the unholy strife of modern political warfare." He said, "If I ever got a wife, I would hope she would be interested in politics, among other public things." But by that statement, I don't mean to say that she would take an active part in politics. She writes back to him, "Joseph, just say you're a Democrat. Of course you're a Democrat. Are you not? You should declare yourself. Mama said it's the only way to decide her case, to lay it before you and let you decide." She is ardently Democrat. She attends the conventions and hands out buttons. She was thinking about running for state representative when she's in her 20s. And one of the most delightful discoveries is to find a young Latter-day Saint woman in the 1890s who was really, really interested in what was going on and was in every way kind of his peer as an intellectual. They dueled back and forth. And another layer that we need to add here is Joseph, when he goes to the University of Michigan to get his master's degree, is the presiding officer over a branch of about 60, Alice Louise Reynolds, Richard Lyman, or some of the people that he presides over. But when he goes to Johns Hopkins, he is, for all intents and purposes, the only Latter-day Saint there. And there's no branch for him to attend. Apparently there were one or two other students from Utah, but he never mentions having any interactions with them. And his faith is sort of affected. For example, one of the letters that he writes to her, he goes, "It's a little amusing to see some pious people. They seem to think that religion consists principally in going to church. But I must confess that, judged by this standard, I've lost nearly all my religion. I have been to church once since May 30th. What do you think of will become of me? Don't the prospects frighten you?" In fact, there are letters from Joseph's mother and father where they basically think that he's leaving the church and that he's losing his testimony and that they're worried about him becoming an apostate, and they're not sure if it was the best idea to travel east. Well, he shares some of his candid feelings with Laura about some of this stuff. For example, She writes to him and remarks about something that I wouldn't think would even be an issue in the 1890s, but she basically writes and says, I think women should hold the priesthood. Women should be ordained officers within the church. The same guy who basically is touting the fact that he's not very religious right now writes back to her and says this, I could laugh at such a remark from one whom I knew had no faith in Mormonism, for the most obvious inference is that the church is governed by men, not by Jesus Christ himself through men as agents. Laura, do you not see that to say the church is narrow in this thing is to say that God is narrow, that he is unjust? The Lord has said, upon whom the priesthood may be conferred, and until he says it may be conferred upon women, no officer in the church can so confer it. You sure understand that if you will reflect a moment. If you do, then you will remember that I have an unshaken belief that Christ has not deserted the church, that he is with it today as much as ever. You may understand that you could never stir. So at the same time that he's sort of waffling in his faith, when he's agitated a little bit, he comes back and basically bears his testimony to her in the letter. Well, she responds in kind, asking about women and priesthood. I do not doubt for a moment that Christ is not with his church, nor do I think that every officer in the church could confer any order of the priesthood unless he had authority from God. I believe that God reveals himself to his prophet on the earth as much today when it is necessary as he did to Joseph Smith. And I would not be a good Mormon did I think otherwise. Why can he not reveal that it is well that women who is worthy can hold the priesthood? We are not given all revelations at once. We are not prepared for them all. We grow near to God and fit ourselves for fresh revelations. He will reveal more of his will to us. And this is where her writing gets really small, because you can tell that she's sort of passionate, and it was hard to read this. There's a few question marks in here because I wasn't sure what she wrote. Joseph Smith, in organizing the Relief Society of Nauvoo, said that he intended to making a society of priestesses in the days of Enoch. He did not say priestesses, and there were unmarried women in that society. Could he not have foreseen what God was to reveal? If the priesthood gives a person any greater advantages or blessings and helps them reach higher, does not a tender, loving father think as much for the welfare of his daughters as for the advancement for that of their sons? If the members of the church are yet narrow-minded, God is not. He may, in pity for us, keep many things back because we're not yet ready to receive them. Now, I'm not trying to paint a picture here of Laura Hyde as a raging apostate. I'm just bringing this up to say that some of the issues that we've struggled with at the last general conference, were issues that they were wrestling with back in the 1890s. And they were using some of the same arguments back and forth that we use today with each other. Now, they discussed polygamy. There's a letter where Laura basically says, I have a testimony that polygamy is true. I'm just so grateful that I didn't have to live it while it was going on. There's another place. Tell me if you couldn't take this and post it on the internet, and it might be something that someone was writing about the church right now. This is Joseph II, Laura, 1896. You said that the sending out of so many missionaries indicate that the authorities feel the time is short. I am strongly inclined to believe that they have another feeling, that is feeling for the safety of the church rather than members thereof. That there is a wave, and a high one, of unbelief and distrust sweeping over the church, I cannot doubt. To save the young men, to give them a measure of faith that they do not possess, there are still on missions in large numbers. The church will thus be greatly strengthened and the elements of decay destroyed, not so much by the addition of new members as by the real conversion of its present members. Well, that's an argument I could hear somebody making today about the new age for missionaries and the reasons why they're called. Now, like I said, he doesn't doubt the faith, but it's clear that while he is in Baltimore, he struggles with some of these deeper questions. And his letters to Laura were, for the most part, therapy, where he's trying to work out the issues of all the things that he's learning in his university education with all the things that he was taught growing up. One of the real interesting contrasts, and I just finished writing the chapter on his youth, is that Joseph Merrill's father, Mariner Merrill, was this visionary man, in the best sense of the word. When he's converted to the church, he has a vision where he sees everything about it, right down to the fact that he's going to be called upon to practice plural marriage. If you've read Temples of the Most High, you know that there's an urban legend about him coming face-to-face with Satan outside the Logan Temple and confronting him there. Well, Joseph, when he's 8 years old, goes to pray and is expecting the same sort of visionary experience, and nothing happens. In fact, he frankly says, I prayed every night for the next 10 years and received no response at all until a few nights before I was supposed to depart home and go to the University of Deseret. And he doesn't describe a visionary experience. He says, I felt a warm and powerful feeling come over me that everything that I had been taught as a youth was true. In other words, he's a great figure because he represents this era where we transition from magnificent visions and angels into an era where most members of the church receive the promptings of a still small voice and by warm feeling. And that feeling enough, he later on says, I think came at a particular time because the Lord knew the struggles that I would have at the University of Deseret. His uncle, Joseph Kingsbury, follows almost the same track as him. He goes east and he loses his testimony of the gospel. Now Joseph's going east and his mother, Joseph Kingsbury's sister, realizes that there's a good possibility that he might lose it too. He doesn't lose his testimony, but he's very clear on the train coming back that he has accepted that while he believes in Mormonism, he is not going to actively pursue any involvement in the church. He's on the train, and he suddenly has the second grand theophany of his life, where this feeling comes that completely rebukes him and tells him, not only are you going to be active in the church, I'm going to give you a calling, you're going to be Richard Lyman's first counselor in the Young Men's Association for the Salt Lake State. And he gets off the train, and Richard Lyman is standing right there to extend the call to him. Well, he came back and not only became an enthusiastic proponent of the church, but he spends the rest of his life trying to reconcile the things that almost derailed him when he was a young man at Johns Hopkins. For example, flash forward about 12 years. Joseph Merrill's children are now attending a high school. The day of the church academies in Utah is starting to eclipse. And he knows that his kids are going to attend Granite High School, which isn't a church academy. Well, he's sitting there at a family home evening with his now wife, Laura, and she's reading stories from the Book of Mormon. He pulled her aside afterwards and said, where did you learn these stories? She said, in James E. Talmadge's theology class at the Salt Lake Academy. And he decides, if I'm going to send my kids to a secular educational environment like the one that I attended, I want to make sure that they have a place where they can go and be taught the scriptural story. So they built the Granite Seminary, which, what does the Granite Seminary look a lot like? A house. I found this out, honestly, 2 weeks ago. It's a myth that's been passed down to the church physical facilities department, but they built it as a house just in case it failed so that they could sell it as a house the next year. The Granite Seminary is this incredibly tiny little environment. They recruit the very first teacher, Thomas Yates. My first article that I wrote was on Thomas Yates because I found his autobiography when I was writing my master's thesis. He is a great, great sort of forerunner for what a seminary teacher in the church is like today. He's part-time. He leaves his job at the Murray Power Plant and goes down, but he is incredibly educated. Thomas Yates was a Cornell University graduate in engineering, and he's the first person that basically sits down and they decide the scriptures are going to be their basic curriculum, and his job is to take the secular truths that they learn at Granite High mesh them with the spiritual and sacred truths of the gospel. Well, flash forward now about 20 years. The seminary system was not only established at Granite in the next few years, partially because of financial needs, and partially because it was just a more economical system, replaces the academy. Joseph Merrill in 1928 is recruited to become the Church Commissioner of Education. And as he comes into the church commissionership, he inherits from Adam S. Benyon this new project, which was labeled Collegiate Seminaries, what we call the Institute Program. So he recruits, or the first presidency, I should say, rather, recruits this guy named J. Wiley Sessions, who just got back from being a mission president in South Africa. I wrote my second article about J. Wiley Sessions, and sends him to Moscow. And this wonderful correspondence exists between Merrill and Sessions, where they try and basically lay the foundation for what's going to be collegiate seminary. For example, this is what he writes in. Personally, I am convinced that religion is as reasonable as science, that religious truths and scientific truths nowhere are in conflict, that there is one great unifying purpose extending throughout all creation. We are living in a wonderful, though at the present time deeply mysterious world, that there is an all-wise, all-powerful creator to back it all. Can this same faith be developed in the minds of all our collegiate and university students? Our collegiate institutes are established as a means to an end. Now, I think you can draw a direct line from Joseph Merrill at Johns Hopkins University struggling in his faith to the Institute program. He realizes that he wants something that he didn't have when he was attending at his university studies. He wanted someone, some authority, some teacher that could basically take him aside every once in a while and just say, here are the things that you learned in your classes, and here's the gospel, and here's how they connect together, and how your university studies shouldn't tear down your faith, they should in a lot of ways strengthen your faith. And writing back and forth, he and Sessions create the first institute curriculum. Now, how does this relate to us here at BYU? Well, within the next year or two, there's a huge crisis in church education where the seminary teachers, which it's now widespread in Utah, Arizona, Idaho, get in trouble with the state of Utah because they are teaching secular doctrines in seminary classes where credit is allowed. Originally, credit was allowed in Old Testament and New Testament courses. And for example, one of the teachers in one of these courses was getting up and saying that the Garden of Eden was in Missouri, and that's obviously not biblical. It's not secular enough to qualify for state credit. So the Utah State Board actually voted to outlaw Release Time Seminary, which in its infancy, with no concept of early morning or outside the day teaching, there were religion classes, but those were never really successful, could end the system altogether. So Joseph Merrill is able to use his connections at the University of Utah and his work in higher education, which he's done for 30 years, to sort of stave that off. And he is able to protect the seminary system from being destroyed, but he realizes that the seminary teachers are just not trained enough to do the job that they need to do. One of the first letters he sends out as commissioner is telling all seminary teachers that they have to at least have a high school degree in order to teach seminary. So he decides that a training school needs to be set up for the seminary institute teachers. And the chief and leading educational institution in the church at the time is Brigham Young University, which has a director of theology, but at the time, not a theology department. George Brimhall is the director of theology, but the way theology worked in church academies was that you would recruit an English teacher, a mathematics teacher, and they would just teach a religion class. There were no specialists in religion. Joseph Merrill appoints his chief lieutenant, a guy named Guy Wilson, who's the second seminary teacher at Granite High, to come down to BYU and start a theology department. Then he chooses several promising seminary teachers. Among them was a guy named Sidney Sperry, T. Edgar Lyon, Russell Swenson, Heber Snell, and tells them that he wants them to go and get theology degrees so that they can create a theology department at BYU with the primary purpose of training seminary teachers. In fact, this is a letter that he writes about the director of the Moscow Institute. So Sessions moves on to start a new institute. This is when they're sending Sperry up to take over for him. He said, our director should have a scholarship in the biblical and religious field comparable to the scholarship that the university would demand of anyone appointed to head on the departments. For example, if the university is looking for someone to head the department of physics, it should limit its search to a trained physicist. 2 years ago, Brother Sperry was probably the only available man in the church who could meet this requirement. Another letter from the time. The Department of Religious Education must have its staff of teachers specialists in the field who are devoting their whole time to this work. This, of course, would not exclude teaching help from other departments, but sooner or later, the teaching of this department must be done mainly by specialists in the department. Now, I recognize the irony in talking about the need for specialists when I'm applying for a generalist position to fill up in the religion department here, but this really gets to the root of why this department is here and why it exists in the first place. Joseph Merrill almost loses his testimony as a young man because there's no one there to connect the secular and the spiritual together. And one of his main works as commissioner was to bolster up and strengthen at the chief church university, a department that could do those two things that weren't done for him as a young man. Sperry, Swenson, that entire group go east, and for some of them it's a wonderful experience, for some of them it's a testimony injuring experience. They come back, but they immediately start making waves in the church. If you read the charted course of the church in education, for example, there's a direct connection between some of these Chicago scholars that Joseph Merrill recruits and what was happening in the Seminary Institute of BYU systems due to the infusion of secular scholarship. The point is, he earnestly believed, because of his experiences, that if we had trained specialists in religion, it wasn't going to destroy the church, that it could be a good thing and a strengthening thing and a building thing for the church. And to discover that early origin, that those struggles that he had when he was there, was really, really edifying for me. To know that, well, it, first of all, it's very rare to get a personal glimpse into the lives of the men that later on became apostles. And honestly, to know that they went through some of the same struggles that I went through. I mean, I was reading some of this stuff while I was getting my PhD and wrestling with some of the same issues as him. It was very, very moving and edifying. Now, that's all I'm going to say about that. I want to talk about something else really briefly. The second grand theme of my research has kind of been global church education around the world. Like I mentioned, I got some things from Dale LeBaron, but over the last couple of years, it's been a personal project of mine to contact people around the world and gather materials. For example, this is a picture of the very first seminary class outside the United States. This was in Melbourne, Australia. John Gibson, who was the teacher of this class, sent his picture. This is one of the first seminary classes in the Philippines. And this is a picture of Robert Stout and the guy next to Michelle Suzuki, who's the very first indigenous seminary teacher, religious educator in Japan. There's a direct line, I think, from Joseph Merrill and this idea that we need to show people how to connect the worlds of secular and spiritual scholarship into what we do on a worldwide basis right now. I hope some of you recognize this guy. Is there anybody that was here when Brother Tom Bowden was on faculty? The very first seminary teacher recruited in Korea was a guy named Lee Ho-nan, who was friends with Gordon B. Hinckley and was recruited without any training to just basically start religious education in the Korean Peninsula. Brother Ho-nan later on came here and was on faculty at BYU until he passed away a couple of years ago. But one of the challenges in writing global history of the church comes from the fact that, one, it's really hard to contact people in other countries, and two, if you do, they usually don't speak English. What I found was that, at least in looking at our development as a global church, the CES was a great window into it because, one, everybody that works for CES has a laptop and you can email, and number two, they all speak English. The number three reason was that, for better or worse, these indigenous religious educators also became the ecclesiastical authorities. Lee Ho-nan's a good example. Not only was he the first seminary teacher in Korea, he's also the first stake president once Korea progresses far enough to have a stake. Then he was recruited as the first indigenous Korean to serve as a mission president. A little bit later on, after Brother Ho-nan came to the United States, he was willing to sit down and tell everybody his story, which he did entirely in English. And then we can take that story and use it to teach. But kind of looking at global church through this this window of religious education has been another interesting pursuit of mine. So a lot of my research goes back to religious education and what its function and purpose is in the church. But it's a window, I think, that expands a lot of things from global Mormonism to how we've developed intellectually as a church to just basically how we relate to the world and how we understand the scriptures. So that's my presentation in a nutshell. I'd like to open up for questions now. Does anybody have any questions they want to ask about anything that I've brought up here? Yeah.
You knew I would, right?
Question here.
Have you been able to read what Joseph Merrill's response was then to this crisis that hits here at BYU when the Chicago crew come back?
Yeah.
How does he respond to that?
When the crisis reaches its peak, he's in England. And that's a whole other story. He's in England, and Gordon B. Hinckley is his assistant. He's actually the person that sends President Hinckley to church headquarters to tell them that they need better stuff than they're teaching the gospel. But when he comes back, he and John A. Widsoe are really seen as the two chief apostles in relation to religious education. And over in the Lee Library in President Clark's, J. Reuben Clark's journals, there's records of a lot of conversations that happened between Joseph Merrill and J. Reuben Clark about what was going on at BYU and what was going on at seminaries and institutes. Joseph Merrill himself was willing to send a letter to some of the religious educators to basically say, look, we want you to be top scholars, but your need for scholarship does not override the need to teach faith and testimony. That the fundamentals of the gospel are more important than you publishing a prize-winning paper in whatever category. But depending on who you talk to, some of the Chicago scholars also said that Joseph Merrill approached them. The one that I'm thinking of in particular is the guy who was the institute director up in Moscow, George Tanner. Joseph Merrill approached him and said, I didn't think it was a mistake to send you guys to Chicago. I think it was a good thing. And for all the hubbub that surrounds the Chicago scholars, and kind of we tend to focus on the negative side of that episode, we forget the fact that Sidney Sperry was one of these guys. That prior to 1930 or so, outside of the general authorities, outside of guys like Orson Pratt and B.H. Roberts, there weren't any religious scholars in the church. And what Sidney Sperry was able to do, applying the tools he gained in Chicago for religious scholarship, has completely changed the way we interact with the scriptures. Sidney Sperry was one of the really strong proponents in the church that we should be using the Book of Mormon more. That the Book of Mormon was worth more than just a missionary tract, but it was really a strong theological tool. Sidney Sperry produces some of the earliest and best scholarship when it relates to church history and the doctrine and covenants. But there's letters between Sidney Sperry and some of his colleagues, like T. Edgar Lyons, for example, where they were still grappling with the fact of how do we properly apply historical tools to the gospel. One that springs to mind is, everybody knows that story where Joseph Smith goes back to the Hill Cumorah, and it's kind of a secondhand story that Oliver Cowdery supposedly told Brigham Young. And the hill opens up, and in the room there's stacks and stacks of plates and a table, and the sword of Laban is there and a sheath and unsheathed. There's a letter between T. Edgar Lyon and Sidney Sperry where they're basically grappling with the fact of, do we teach that in full context? Because in the discourse where Brigham Young originally shared that, he also talked about how there were veins of gold in the mountains and that the angels had hidden them up. And they didn't know, they were trying to deal with, what do we take? And given that it's a third-hand account, how much should we use that in our classes? And I think that that approach today is really bearing fruit in the church, to where stuff like the Joseph Smith papers and some of our historical inquiry has asked us to say, look, I know the story might be inspirational, but maybe it's more important that we look at the context and how much we can source it and whether or not we can firmly say that this is real and true. And those issues are still being played out today, I mean, honestly. Merrill felt good about bringing in secular scholarship, but I think at the same time, he may have, in my judgment, had a little bit too much faith in how useful that would be to us. What it would do in the church. I don't know if he anticipated the chart, of course. That would be one of those. Good question. Thank you. Any other questions? Yeah, Tom.
Do you know his response to the chart, of course? I know he didn't anticipate it, but after that, you know, there's records when the chart, of course, was given, they immediately divided into two camps. What was Merrill's response to Clark's approach with coming down fairly hard on some of the more liberal scholars, you know?
That's difficult to say, because like I said, he wasn't there at Aspen Grove when the charting course was given. By that time, he wasn't Commissioner of Education, and there had been two commissioners since, and Johnny Witzel becomes commissioner after, and then a guy named Franklin West. And West is the commissioner there. But about 3 years later, in 1941, Joseph Merrill sends a letter that echoes a lot of the language of the Charter Course. In other words, he was very, very on board with scholarship, but a common thing is, one of the Chicago scholars, a guy named Wes Lloyd, who later on becomes the Dean of Students at BYU, actually comes to the church office building, and a lot of the things that he says today are sometimes used against the church. A lot of people would say that B.H. Roberts lost his faith in the Book of Mormon come from Wes Lloyd, because Wes Lloyd went to the church administration building and sat down with B.H. Roberts, and B.H. Roberts said something to the equivalent of, the Book of Mormon is the aspect of our faith that needs the most bolstering. Well, apparently at the same time, Wes Lloyd went down the hall to Joseph Merrill and started asking him the same questions, and Joseph Merrill just said, you don't need to mess with those mysteries. Honestly, you know that the gospel is true. If the details are a little bit fuzzy, don't worry too much about it. And by the way, one of the other great things about his collection over there is his entire apostolic correspondence is on record. It was back in the day and age when people felt completely free to write the Quorum of the Twelve with a doctrinal question. And Merrill's most common response when he was confronted with something that was really, really nettlesome was to just say, it's a mystery, and I don't know the answer in particular. But I have faith in the restored gospel of Jesus Christ, and I know that Joseph Smith was a prophet of God. And that was his answer on everything from blacks and the priesthood, which people were wondering about and writing about in the 1940s, to plural marriage. His letter on plural marriage, he basically says, I grew up in a home where plural marriage was practiced, and I felt I had a great upbringing, but I don't strictly know the reasons why the Lord chose to implement that and then chose to rescind it. He was one of the original... I wonder a lot what his influence was on Harold B. Lee, because you see in Merrill's writings a lot of times the genesis of those early statements Harold B. Lee was going to make, where he'd say stuff to teachers like, it's okay to say I don't know, or don't teach them so that they can understand, teach them so they can't possibly misunderstand. But Merrill was frankly honest to say, I don't know on some of these, but I have faith. So I think he was very, very in line with President Clark and on his side, but at the same time, I think it pained him a little bit that, and I don't know if President Clark intended this, but seminaries and institutes at least swung away from being strong intellectuals for a little while. There's a story that T. Edgar Lyon tells where Merrill came to the Salt Lake Institute, and there were a set of classrooms, and then next door there was a recreation hall where they'd have parties and dances and stuff like that. And Merrill expressed a little bit of sorrow that that was there, that he really, I think, intended seminaries and institutes to be a little bit more intellectual than it's turned out to be. Yeah. Good question.
It seems interesting that he would intend it to be more intellectual and yet give non-intellectual responses to intellectual questions.
That is one of the contradictions that exists in his character, to where I think his work as a specialist in the field of physics, that's what he finally winds up getting his graduate degree in, made him very comfortable with the idea of specialists. That he didn't think anybody was going to go out and discover anything about the gospel that would bring the whole structure crashing down. But he himself was not a specialist in the field of religion. In fact, one of the real interesting things about Joseph Merrill's era is that in a period of time when religion and science were absolutely diametrically opposed to each other, I mean, 3 years before his letter to J. Wiley Sessions, the Scopes trial in Tennessee has just happened. And at a time when, boy, religion is setting themselves up as complete opponents to those that study science, there's prominent religionists in the Quorum of the Twelve. There's Joseph Merrill, Richard Lyman, James Talmadge, Johnny Witzel. The Quorum of the Twelve in the 1930s was packed with secular scholars. And Joseph Merrill, probably of all of them, was the least religiously trained of all of them. He writes the least about it. He was brought into the Quorum of the Twelve, I think, honestly, because he was a wonderful administrator and a great leader in that sense, but his religious teachings don't have the depth of, say, John A. Woodstone or James E. Talmadge. For the most part, I think he didn't have to struggle with those issues because where Talmadge is a geologist and he has to deal with evolution and things like that, Merrill was a physicist. Merrill writes one book, The Truth Seeker in Mormonism, and I'd say 80% of the book is about science and not necessarily the gospel. But his position when it came to science was, look at how the structure of the universe and the things as I observe them honestly testify to me that there is a God, that there is another one. He spent 6 pages talking about like the thermodynamic properties of water and how it indicates design and not chaotic practice. So I think physics made his testimony so strong in the gospel that he didn't really worry a lot about historical questions and inquiry because it was just so clear to him in his mind that, well, look around. It's kind of an Alma 30 argument, right? The heavens themselves testify that there is a God. He was really a proponent of that sort of thought. And I'm not saying that his thought was shallow because it's clear from his writings that he was incredibly learned and trained. But when it came to religion, he was pretty comfortable just saying, I don't know. I don't know about that, and I'm comfortable waiting until the Lord reveals a little bit more about it to us. Which is interesting. Yeah, Brother Ben.
Besides his vision of our religion here at BYU, what did he anticipate Brigham Young University becoming? What was his vision in the overall plan of church education? Where did he see BYU as a university?
That's a good question, and one that I do have a pretty firm answer to. Merrill's the axeman in a lot of ways when he gets brought into the church commissionership. It's partly because all of the academies, save a few that were turned into junior colleges, have been sent away. They were either converted into state high schools or just closed completely. By the time he gets made commissioner, you still have Dixie, Snow, Weber, Ricks, and the College of Arizona Eastern University. that are still retained under church control. And one of the first things that he's told by the first presidency is basically, we are getting out of the secular education or business. We're going to close all our church schools, and we're just going to operate seminaries and institutes. Because Heber J. Grant was very bottom-line businessman. There's breakdowns that Adam Benyon had given to the Church Board of Education that basically said it costs this much to educate a kid at a church school and this much to educate them at seminaries and institutes. And it was, I think, around $240 for a church school and $10 for seminary and institute. So one of the first things that happens to Joseph Merrill is they tell him, we're going to start withdrawing from the further secular education. In fact, there's a Church Board of Education meeting in 1929 where basically they bring up the question of, should we close all the schools? And you guys know who the big proponent of church schools is, right, Sister Richard? It's President McKay. President McKay is the one saying, we can't separate the secular and the spiritual, and that's going to happen if you just have seminaries and institutes. But basically they come out and say, well, we can't afford to close them, we can't afford to keep them open. And somebody in the meeting actually says, does this mean that we have to close BYU? And it doesn't say in the minutes who responded, but someone says, yes, we should consider closing BYU as well. And it doesn't say what Merrill's response is in the meeting, but the next day he writes a letter to Franklin S. Harris that basically says, we are not going to close BYU. I want BYU to become the Johns Hopkins University of the West. And then a few months later, he comes to BYU and gives a major address where he outlines three reasons why BYU should continue to exist. The number one reason, he said, was we need a place to train seminary and institute teachers. And this was right after all the seminary teachers got in trouble with the state board. So he actually takes that crisis and uses it as an opportunity to say, do you see why we need a church school? Because our seminary teachers are a bunch of yokels and they don't know what they're saying in the classroom. We need a religion faculty that can train them. But then he gives two other reasons. He said, not only that, we need a place where the finest specialists in every field of scientific endeavor can teach, but also prove that you can have a testimony in the gospel. In other words, we need experts in all fields of scientific pursuit that also believe in the gospel. And the third reason, he said, was we need a shining light to the world. We need to highlight for the world what the restored gospel can do to an intellectual. In a lot of ways, Joseph F. Merrill, Richard R. Lyman, David O. McKay all play a role in keeping BYU in the system. His papers indicate that it was never in his thoughts to get rid of BYU. BYU was going to be his model that he would use to display to the world what Mormonism could do. But yeah, a lot of his work was to get rid of Weber and Dixie and Snow, and as hard as he tried Ricks, but he just couldn't manage to get that over to anybody as hard as he tried to. And to be honest with you, Joseph Merrill's name is still reviled up in Rexburg because he was basically the one that came up and said, we can't pay for your school anymore. We're trying to give you guys to Idaho, but Idaho doesn't want you, so we don't know what to do. Later on, when Joseph Merrill's on his mission, President McKay swoops in and cements Rick's status. But I think Joseph Merrill has a lot to do with why we're here. His work as commissioner really sort of stabilized it. But another factor that I haven't even brought up is the Great Depression, where a lot of his correspondence as commissioner is him writing to BYU leaders saying, I want BYU to stay, but everybody's going to have to take a pay cut because the finances of the church have been devastated by the Great Depression. If we want to keep this institution, everybody has to sacrifice and pull together. But he really, in his mind, the seminary and institute system and BYU were meant to work in tandem. They were supposed to be hand in hand doing what they did. And a big part of why he maintained BYU, and I know sometimes religious education gets treated like they're the redheaded stepchild on the campus, but it was his main argument for why BYU should continue to exist, is we've got to have an institution that can prepare us for the attacks that might be made on religion scholars against Mormonism. And I think over the course of almost a century, that idea has borne fruit and really proved the wisdom that Joseph Merrill had. When you think of how sophisticated some of the attacks on the church have become, the fact that we have a team of dedicated scholars here that do study religion and know what everybody's talking about and interact with religionists from other faiths in their field has really helped the church withstand some of the major attacks that have been launched on. And I'm thinking of everything from, I don't know, the Salamander papers to just the things that we read about on the internet today. BYU scholarship is a shield to the church and has been a huge blessing in the lives of millions of church members. because we have professionals here that are conversant with other professionals in the fields of religion and can speak when someone makes a concerted and intellectual attack on the church. Does that answer your question?
Very well, thank you. So we'll stick around for a while.
I hope so.
If you take a pay cut.
Now, at the same time, I should say that there were some people at BYU that strongly felt that seminaries and institutes were the wrong way to go. There was a professor here named Lowry Nilsson who wrote a very passionate letter to Joseph Merrill basically saying, you cannot separate religion from all the other subjects. That's a mistake. That you needed in your... We needed church schools because we couldn't... We didn't want to send our kids to a place where they would learn geology or English or physics without a faithful scholar of the gospel. And I don't know. Honestly, I've worked in the church office building for the last six months. And I've been really pushy and asked about their studies that they've done. And for the most part, a student that attends institute and graduates has as good a chance of being faithful and active in the church as a student that graduates from BYU. The problem is when you look at the percentage of kids that come to BYU and graduate and the percentage of kids that enroll in institute and graduate, there's a huge disparity. But when you look at the fact that I don't think we could have BYU in 215 countries right now, but we can have seminaries and institutes in 215 countries, it was a reasonable compromise. And that's kind of what Joseph Merrill's life was all about, was how do we bridge the gap between those two worlds in the most effective economic way? He knew everyone was going to be able to come to BYU. BYU was a little farm college when Granite Seminary was started. And so he had to come up with some sort of alternative plan so that kids are taught religion in a professional, systematized way so that they could stand up against some of the temptations and problems that they've been faced. I think for the most part, it's been a successful strategy. I think the church would have gone bankrupt if we tried to establish BYU everywhere. And that's an argument that every generation in the church deals with. Should we have church schools or just teach religion? I don't know the answer to that fully, but I know that so far it's worked out pretty well, and I don't see us deviating off the course of the future. Sometimes I worry that I'm going to lose my job at BYU, it's going to continue on, that we will basically get rid of professional religious educators outside of BYU and just have volunteers to them. But it really appears that we do need professionals to sort of guide and help the process. Now, I say that recognizing that for every professional religious educator in the church, there are thousands and thousands of people to get up every morning to teach the gospel. But who writes their curriculum? And who determines what's important? And who actually has the time to go out and read all those journals and scientific studies and everything so that they're armed with the kind of knowledge that they need? It would be hard to imagine that happening without professional religionists in the church. So for while better or worse, we have Pharisees in the church. Pharisees can be a good thing sometimes. As long as they understand that they work under prophets and apostles, and the prophets and apostles have some. I'm sorry, I've used up all your time.
Thank you.
We'd like to thank Casey for spending these minutes.
Your scriptures open up to section 85 of the Doctrine and Covenants. And just to vary the monotony, to change the class up a little bit, I'm occasionally going to have you discuss something with a person. So can everybody find a person? Like Jessica, you and Ivan, okay? Your friends, all right? There's you two right here, you two right there. Just turn to them right now and say hi. Okay, and the person that's wearing the darker shirt goes first. Tell them where you were born and how old you are, all right? Ready, set, go. Okay, that's enough. All right, tell me who thinks their partner comes from the furthest away from Provo.
That would be
where from? This is your wife. Your wife is your partner, Stuart, right? You come from Ohio? Do you want to be Ohio?
What is it?
Barnard was born in the Philippines.
You were born in the Philippines.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I'm pretty sure that's further than Ohio. Okay, and who comes from the closest place? Probably this guy from Springfield back here. Oh, wait, you're from Spanish Fork.
I was born.
You were born in the Provo Hospital.
I was born in Provo.
Okay, so it's going to turn into a contest where someone's like, I was born in the Joseph F. Smith building. Okay, now to start the class, I know that sometimes in class you get asked a question and you don't have time to think of an answer and it gets all awkward, so I'm going to give you the questions beforehand and you have the entire 15-minute period to think of an intelligent answer. We will get to all these in succession. But just think right now, you don't have to raise your hand and shout out, about how you might answer some of these questions. For example, what does it mean to steady the arc? What does it mean to steady the arc? Now break that down into parts. What's an arc? What does it mean to steady? How do we use the in this particular context? Next question. Why does the Lord allow the wicked to carry out their works? If the Lord knows everything, past, present, and future, then he knows who's going to be bad. Why not just kill them when they're 3 years old so that they don't cause any problems for the rest of us? Okay, think about that. All right, last question. What's the difference between a prophecy and a prediction? So we're all comfortable when we have an election, say, with somebody coming out and saying, I predict that this is what will happen. But what separates a prophecy from someone just looking at the data and predicting what the outcome will be, okay? So keep all these questions in your mind and think of a good answer, and I promise we'll get there. Let's go to section 85 first, okay? Section 85, I've labeled, for better or worse, the book of the law of the Lord. Let me give you a little bit of context about it, okay? Section 85 is an excerpt from a letter that Joseph Smith wrote to W.W. Phelps. Phelps was a leader of the church in Missouri. And this letter in particular has to do with the bishop of the church in Missouri. Can anyone tell me what that guy's name was?
Edward Partridge.
Oh, good job, Brother Menzel. You taught these people. Yeah. Edward Partridge was having issues with people moving to Missouri but refusing to live the law of consecration. In fact, it was a big deal to move to Missouri. They didn't even use the word Missouri when they described it back then. What word did they use for Missouri instead of Missouri?
Zion.
Zion, yeah. And why did they call it Zion? What's that?
That's where the prophecy was that it would be.
Right. All throughout the Doctrine and Covenants, one of the big themes is that they're going to build this city. And leading up to this, they find out in incremental pieces, starting in the Book of Mormon and the Book of Ether, and all the way into the Doctrine and Covenants, that there's going to be a city called Zion. And they finally found out it's going to be in Missouri. And it's such a big deal that if you want to move to Zion, you have to commit to live the law of consecration. And apparently some of these people were having issues with living the law of consecration when they got there. So Joseph Smith writes a letter with instructions. You get a chance to read the whole letter, but there were certain sections of it where he spoke in the name of the Lord. They were extracted and became section 85 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Well after Joseph Smith passed away, Brigham Young was the one who put this into the Doctrine and Covenants. So let's take a look at the context, or the content, really fast. Everybody jump down to, say, verse 3, 4, and 5. Is there anybody in the class that can read that for me? Go ahead, Jeff.
It is contrary to the will and commandment of God that those who receive not their inheritance by consecration, agreeable to his law, which he has given that he may tithe his people, to prepare them against the day of vengeance and burning, should have their names enrolled with the people of God. Neither is their genealogy to be kept or to be had where it may be found on any of the records or history of the church. Their names shall not be found, neither the names of the fathers nor the names of the children written in the book of the law of God, saith the Lord of hosts.
Okay, later on in the Doctrine and Covenants, he's going to talk a little bit about what the book of the law of God is. But what he's basically saying here is this. If you don't live the law of consecration, what's the consequence?
You're not recorded.
Yeah, you're not going to be recorded. You got to do this if you're going to commit to be a member of the church in Zion. And later on, he uses a phrase that I want to pay particular attention to that, for lack of more context, maybe gives us an idea of what was happening in the church here in Missouri. Go to verse 8. It says, while that man who was called of God and appointed, so this could be referring to Bishop Partridge, that putteth forth his hand to steady the ark of God, shall fall by the shaft of death, like as a tree that is smitten by the vivid shaft of life. That is where we use that particularly vivid phrase about steadying the ark of God. Okay? Now, our first question. What does it mean to steady the ark? Go ahead, Ivan.
In particular, it's in reference to there were the people during the time of Moses, like sometime during the Exodus, I think, there were the Levites were the ones who were ordained to carry the Ark of the Covenant, and no one else was allowed to touch it. And there was a certain point where, I don't remember exactly what was going on, but the Ark, like, someone slipped and the Ark started to stumble, and a random person who was not a Levite tried to reach forward and hold the Ark up, you know, hold it steady. But because he was not a Levite, and that was contrary to the laws of the Lord, he was struck dead immediately.
Okay. Now, first of all, when I say the Ark of the Covenant, what sort of images spring into your mind?
Yeah, Nazis
with their faces melting off because they looked at the Ark of the Covenant. And this is honestly one of those stories that sort of led to Indiana Jones discovering that. The story is a little bit later than Moses. Moses is the one that commands them, receives the revelation to build the Ark of the Covenant. This actually happens in 2 Chronicles. And the rest of it happens exactly the way Ivan said. They were carrying the Ark of the Covenant back to Jerusalem, and it looked like it was going to fall, and a guy named Uzzah or Uzziah, depending on which source you read, reached out to touch the Ark of the Covenant and was struck and died. Now, who thinks that sounds a little harsh? Okay, two people. Good. And in reference to this, the Lord in section 85 says, hey, don't steady the Ark, okay? But what are we talking about when we say a person is trying to steady the Ark? Go ahead.
I think of it as going outside of your stewardship, trying to force others to do things. In many cases, as a missionary, it was missionaries trying to force the bishoprics or the branch presidencies to do things, when really their stewardship is to be servants for the bishopric, not telling them what to do, so sort of thing like that. So don't steady the Ark, but make sure that you study the Ark.
Okay, is there anybody else, any other ideas? Go ahead, yeah.
I think it also, like, it's not having faith in God, because obviously the Ark is representing God's power and, like, being in His presence and everything is God or the Father, and so, like, to study it would kind of show that you don't have faith that God can protect that from being harmed. And so it wasn't that His intentions were bad, but He also wasn't worthy to be in the presence of God,
We're being kind of harsh on Uzzah, right? Because it doesn't say anything about his motivations, but maybe that was one. Did you have enough faith that the Ark would be okay, regardless of whether or not you did? That might be one way of looking at it. I thought I saw one other hand. Jeff, go ahead.
It's also the lack of faith in the Lord's leaders who he's appointed. It's like you think that the work of the Lord is about to be frustrated, which it's not, but you go out and you do something to try and prevent it, because you don't have enough faith in who the Lord has called and what the Lord's work is. How it
go. Good. Is your hand up?
Yeah, kind of.
Go ahead.
So the reason why I think it's kind of harsh is just like, if you see something that's about to fall, like, you're going to reach out to grab it. And like, he probably wasn't really thinking through, like, you know, everything, like, oh, well, the Lord will probably make it hover off the ground or something like that, you know? That's why I think sometimes it's harsh. But I get like the lesson it's trying to teach, at least I think I do. I was like, yeah, but.
And we're not judging you. This is a safe space, and you can think what you want to think, really. And by the way, we don't know what was going on in Uzzah's heart and mind. That episode is skeletal enough that we can assume a lot of things. A prophet, though, President McKay, gave an interpretation that's really close to what all of you said, so good job. President McKay said this: it's a little dangerous for us to go out of our sphere and try unauthoritatively to direct the efforts of a brother. Remember the case of Uzzah, who stretched forth his hand to steady the Ark? He seemed justified when the oxen stumbled, and putting forth his hand to steady the symbol of the covenant. We today think his punishment was very severe. Be that as it may, the incident conveys a lesson of life. President McKay continues, "Let us look around and see how quickly men who attempt to unauthoritatively steady the Ark die spiritually. Their souls become embittered, their minds distorted, their judgments faulty, and their spirits depressed. Such is the pitiable condition of men who, neglecting their own responsibilities, spend their time finding faults with others." So if I am a missionary and I'm serving in a ward, but I try to tell the bishop how to run his ward, am I steadying the Ark? Okay, what if I'm an elder and I try to tell the elders quorum president how to run his elders quorum? Now, there's nothing wrong with making suggestions or presenting ideas, but if I'm trying to take over another person's stewardship, am I steadying the Ark? What if I go to my kids and I tell them that they have to read scriptures before they go to bed? No, that's okay, because I'm totally the priesthood leader, and I can order them around as much as I want to, as long as I don't do it anyway. Okay? Now, one last pit stop we need to make in this is this. Back up from the verse we read in section, verse 8, and go to verse 7, okay? Contained within this section is a kind of cryptic prophecy that a lot of people have taken and sometimes misinterpreted in the church. I'm going to ask someone to read that. Let's see here. Go ahead. Will you read that for me? Verse 7.
And it shall come to pass that I, the Lord God, will send one mighty and strong, holding the scepter of power in his hand, clothed with light for a covering, whose mouth shall utter words, eternal words, while his bowels shall be a fountain of truth, to set in order the house of God, and to arrange by lot the inheritances of the saints, whose names are found, and the names of their fathers, and of their children, enrolled in the book of the law of God.
Okay. The Lord doesn't specify who the one mighty and strong is, right? A lot of people have taken this little verse and sort of used it for their own purposes as a way of saying the church is going to go off track at some point and the Lord is going to raise up someone outside the leadership of the church to direct the church. Part of the problem is this a prophecy specific to one occasion or for all time and eternity? If you take it in context, he's really just talking to the church in Missouri. And in particular, 50, 60 years after this prophecy is given, a lot of, say, apostate groups from the church were trying to use this verse in particular to say, oh, the church has gone off track, and I, whoever it was claiming to this, and the one mighty and strong that has been asked to the church. You'll still see it cited occasionally. Would it surprise you if I told you my next-door neighbor is a polygamist? He is. He's a single polygamist. He's not married, okay, but he believes in polygamy. I went to knock on his door, and he introduced himself, and his name is Brigham Marlowe, which is totally a polygamous name if I've ever heard one in my life. And we started talking about these things, and it basically came down to him saying that he believed that his ancestor, his great-grandfather, was the one mighty and strong who was raised up to lead the church the right way when the church went off track. Well, this prophecy in particular became of concern to the first presidency. So the first presidency issued some clarifications here. This is from Joseph F. Smith. This was given in 1905. Inasmuch as through his repentance and sacrifices and suffering, Bishop Edward Partridge undoubtedly obtained a mitigation of the threatened judgment against him of falling by the shaft of death, like as a tree that is smitten by the vivid shaft of lightning, so the occasion for sending another to fill his station, one mighty and strong, who set in order the house of God, and to arrange by lot the inheritance of the saints, may also be considered as having passed away, and the whole incident of the prophecy closed. See, this whole verse kind of hinges on the idea that something's wrong in Zion. And based on what we know, did Bishop Partridge correct the problem?
Yeah,
he did. He wasn't smitten and killed. He died faithful in the church. So the first presidency is just basically saying, case closed, the Lord didn't have to send the one mighty and strong because the problems in Zion were solved the instrument of the church. Does that make sense? Everybody's okay with that? Does anyone in here think that they are the one mighty and strong? Okay, talk to me after class. All right, turn to section 86 of the Doctrine and Covenants, and let's move on to another phase here, okay? Section 86 is a direct relation of Joseph Smith's translation of the Bible. Now, by this point, he's got most of the translation done, but we're just assuming, based on the papers that we have, that he was going through and asking for clarifications. This section is an extrapolation or an explanation on a parable that the Savior gave called the wheat and the pears. And I know that this is a little gospel 101, but when I say a parable, who can tell me what a parable is? Yes, Leanne.
It's a story used to help you understand more doctrinal.
Yeah. The basic idea is the Savior would tell a story. And he didn't always explain the meaning to it, the idea being that those that have the spirit and discernment could understand the story, and those that didn't would just say, that's a nice story. Elder McConkie talks a little bit about how parables worked. He says this, parables seldom clarify a truth, rather they obscure and hide the doctrine involved, so that none but those already enlightened and informed on the very point presented are able to grasp the full meaning. Then he continues, nowhere is this better illustrated than in the parable of the wheat and the tares. When Jesus first gave this parable, even the disciples did not understand it. They asked for the interpretation. He gave it, partially at least, And then with both the parable and the interpretation before the world, the Lord still had to give a special revelation in the latter days so that the full meaning of this marvelous parable might sink into the hearts of men. And that revelation is section 86. This is the Savior coming back to a parable he already explained and saying, here is some further meaning that this has. Okay? So the two explanations to the parable can be found in Matthew 13 and in DNC 86. So turn to your partner again and say, hey. Okay, do you remember who's older and who's younger? The older person, turn to Matthew 13. Okay, the younger person, stay in Doctrine and Covenants, section 86. And just to catch you up, we're just looking at the interpretation. So if you don't remember, the parable basically goes like this, okay? There's a man, and he owns a field. And he goes into the field, and he sows, he plants a bunch of wheat, okay? Then at night, an enemy sneaks into the field, and he plants a bunch of tares in the midst of the wheat. The next day, the man comes out, and they see that there are tares growing in the middle of the wheat, and the servants say, let's pluck them all up, and the master says, no, let's wait until they're fully grown, then we'll gather them, separate the wheat from the tares, and burn the tares. It's going to be fun, and we'll place the wheat in a safe place. Okay? That's basically the parable. Now let's try and figure out how it's interpreted. So those of you in Matthew 13 go to verses 36 to 42. Everybody else just stay in Doctrine and Covenants, section 86. And let's interpret some symbols, okay? So people in Matthew 13, what is the field supposed to represent?
The world.
What does it say? The world, okay? So in this parable, the field represents the world, all right? Then the next two symbols are the sower, the person that plants the seeds, and the enemy that comes and sows the tares, okay? So who is the sower, people in Matthew 13? Son of Man, Christ. Okay, people that are in DNC 86, does he say anything about who the sowers are? Yeah, he adds here another further clarification that the people that planted the seeds weren't just the Savior, it was also the apostles and the work that they did after, okay? All right, then we've got the wheat and the tares. So both of you look, and what are the wheat and the tares supposed to represent? Let's tackle the wheat first. What's the wheat?
Children.
The good guys, the righteous people, okay? And what are the tares? Yeah, the wicked. In fact, here's a little weird thing about wheat and tares, but I'm going to show you a bigger picture of wheat and tares up close, okay? This is a piece of wheat right next to a tare. What's the wheat? Which one's the wheat and which one's the tare?
Wheat's on the left, right?
The wheat's your left or my left? This one or this one? This one? You're right, yeah. This one is the wheat, okay? And this one's the tare. A tare is a noxious weed. It can be poisonous. Can you tell which one's the wheat and the tare pretty easily? Yeah, they look totally different, right? When they're fully grown. The problem is when they're little, when they're first coming out of the ground, can you tell the difference between the two? It's extremely hard to tell. That's partially why in the parable, you go to the next part, and the Savior says, no, we're not going to tear them up while they're young. We're going to wait until they mature. Then we can tell the difference between the wheat and the tares. We'll separate them and burn them. So take a look again in Matthew 13, DNC 86. What are the reapers, or the people that gather, and what is the gathering supposed to represent? This is more of a DNC 86 answer, but
the angels,
okay? So the angels are going to gather all of them together and then separate them. Angels is a loaded term. It can refer to spiritual beings, but who else can this refer to? Our missionaries refer to as angels sometimes. Yeah, so this is a latter-day gathering type of thing. And what would we assume the reaping or the burning is?
And the
world, where the wicked are destroyed and the righteous continue on, okay? So keeping that all in mind, let's look at some of the issues that DNC 86 brings up and tries to answer. First off, we're going to play a little game called Which One is Evil, all right? I'm going to put a picture up here of a baby and another baby, okay? One of these babies grows up to become one of the most evil people in history. And not that I'm judging, but he's evil, okay? One of them grows up to become a prophet of God. I want you to turn to your partner and say, hey.
You have 30 seconds to determine which one is evil and which one's a prophet. Okay? Ready, set, go. Okay. Have you had enough time? Okay. Which one is evil and which one is good?
Left song.
You went like this.
Yeah, he's left.
So, I'm sorry, there's my left and there's your left. Let's say the blonde kid or the dark haired kid. Which one's evil?
Dark haired.
Because he has dark hair. So, Melanie's evil, is that what you're saying? Okay, who else thinks that this kid is the evil kid? Anybody else have a compelling reason? You just don't like the way he's looking at you? Or... Yeah, go ahead, Ray.
He looks kind of like Hitler.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
He Googled Hitler baby pictures.
So, which one's evil? Yeah. This one's evil, okay? This is Adolf Hitler as a baby, and the other one is Joseph Fielding Smith as a baby. But I picked Joseph Fielding Smith because of all the prophets with baby pictures I could find, he kind of has the most malicious expression on his face. I thought that he looked evil. You guys thought that, you know, Hitler as a baby looked like this. Now this raises a question. And someone brought this up in the last class, like, we're talking about how the baby's evil, and, oh, you can tell that he's Hitler. And then one girl raised her hand and said, neither of them is evil. It was just a baby. She laughed. Okay, which brings up this question. But if, and by the way, I'm not trying to be judgmental here, maybe Hitler was a great guy. I misunderstood the facts, but, okay. Would we classify Hitler as the weak or the dead? And let me ask some deeper fundamental questions. Did Heavenly Father know he was going to turn out the way that he did? And he turned out pretty bad, and it caused a lot of misery and suffering for other people. So why didn't God just take out Hitler when he was little for all that bad stuff he had? Okay, let me make this even more difficult, because I want you to think about this. Does God know how to turn out the way? For example, does God know who's going to go to the celestial kingdom and his friend and his father? Go ahead.
I think our Heavenly Father knows like the challenges and the weaknesses that we're going to have, but it's up to us to choose that path. Everyone always has a chance. Like even Hitler, like you mentioned, he lost his life and saw that.
Okay, and I'm not debating that we have that choice, but I'm just saying, does Heavenly Father know what choice we're going to make before we make it? Go ahead.
He's our Father, and he knows us perfectly better than anybody else does. I think given any situation, we can say, this is how they'll respond.
So does he know how we're going to respond, or does he actually know what's going to happen?
Well, he is omniscient, if that makes sense.
Uh-huh.
But, and so he knows all things because he sees. I don't understand exactly how it works, but he sees time in a different way than we do, and he sees the beginning from the end. But for us, this whole life is a time to learn how to make decisions, and so even though he knows how it's going to happen, we don't. And we have the opportunity to learn now in the world how to act and how to actually use our agency in a situation where we can't see ourselves. Where we do have good and evil, and that's why he allows things like Hitler to go and kill lots of people, is because there has to be good, there has to be bad for us to be good. There has to be wickedness, so that there is righteousness, just like it says.
You read the second in page, too, so yeah, go ahead.
I'm on the second reading.
Yeah, sorry.
That she was saying, but if he just killed all of them when they were born or whatever, then our life on Earth would be virtually similar life, and then there wouldn't be any point to be on Earth.
That's what I'm saying. Why the charade? If he knows, why didn't he just line us up in pre-mortality and go, okay, celestial, celestial, terrestrial, outer darkness, celestial, 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 terrestrial? Why go through all this?
Because
Ivan?
Just a couple of things. First of all, like, you know, making everybody do the right thing and, you know, predetermining everyone, that's kind of Satan's plan. That was what Satan's plan was. Like, wanting everybody to do, you know, have a righteous, perfect, righteous world. And so, like, that's kind of Satan's plan. It completely eliminates agency. Another thing is that, I mean, even us in our limited spheres, we can, like, see things that are going to happen. We can predict if somebody's going to do something. It's like, say you're the father of a child. It's like, you know, that child is probably going to, you know, go for the cookies if you put them on top of the refrigerator. You can see that, and it probably will happen. You can know that. So even us with our limited capability, we can see, you know, those things might happen. But are we going to just stop it from happening just because we know something might happen in the future? We're not going to stop it from happening. We let the course, you know, let people exercise their agency because they're agents unto themselves.
So it's sort of like if you guys showed up to class the first day, and I could see the future, or Brother Metzel, or whoever's teaching the class, and said, I know who's going to get an A, and who's going to fail, A, B, C, D, you're going to drop out completely, you're going to get a W, A, B, D. How would you guys feel over that view, sir?
No, what I think is that I'm not certain, because no, possibly that we can know for certain, but I believe if you look at the Bible and the Joseph Smith translation of the Bible, do you think he knows what's probably going to happen? But there are but where it says like this will happen, it says where the Joseph Smith translation says if this happens. So what I personally think is that he knows what we are likely going to do, but there's always a chance where like we're going to do something he didn't expect, but he knew that we were capable of doing.
So does he know?
Like with especially with like a King Hezekiah, where he had Isaiah tell Hezekiah that Hezekiah was going to die, and when Hezekiah basically prayed, he knew that he had Isaiah go back and tell him the opposite.
Okay, you're getting some good examples right here. Sorry,
I don't think like life's about like getting an A or B or C. Like it's not about like okay, so you do these things and good job, you're going to make it to social kingdom. It's about the experiences that we have and like what we learn along the way. Like that's why we come down here, is to experience things for ourselves, like the good and the bad. And so then it's not so much about like completing everything we have to do and then getting an A, but rather about what we learn while we're in the class.
Okay. I'm sorry, I see all these hands. Let me grasp onto what you're saying a little bit. Is getting an A in the class the point?
No, not really, right?
If I just handed out A's the first day of the course, what did you actually take this class for? You hopefully want to learn something about the Doctrine and Covenant. And honestly, whether or not God knows our faith, I believe he does, doesn't affect our choice necessarily, does it? We're not here to prove ourselves to God. God knows who we are and what we're going to do. He knows the future. Who are we trying to prove ourselves to? Yeah, Jeff, what were you going to say?
So if you took Hitler when he was 9 years old and you told him, you're going to kill a whole bunch of people. Or if you took Alma when he was in the heyday of his wickedness and you're like, you're going to get translated one day, they wouldn't believe you. But as they went through and made their choices, they learned for themselves who they ended up becoming.
Yeah,
so the Lord knew exactly what was going to happen with them. And he knew, but he had to let them know for themselves.
Yeah, just like if I told you were going to get an A and you were going to fail the class, well, what if Leanna gets really mad and decides, I'm going to put that jerk wrong, I'm going to be here every day. I've changed the outcome. But there is a reason why he still allows the wicked to fulfill their destiny. Go to section 86, okay? Go to verse 6. He says this, and boy, did this make my head hurt the first time that I read it. Knowing that the righteous are the wheat and the wicked are the tares, the Lord saith unto them, this is verse 6, pluck not up the tares while the blade is yet tender, for verily your faith is weak, lest you destroy the wheat also. In other words, if he kills all the little baby Hitlers out there, what happens to the wheat? He says this action could destroy the wheat. Just like if you reached down and plucked up that baby wheat and that baby tare before they're fully mature, it could destroy it. If the wicked didn't exist on earth, could it affect the righteous? Yeah, in fact, go on a little bit further. Let the wheat, this is verse 7, and the tares grow together until the harvest is fully ripe. Then ye shall first gather out the wheat from among the tares, and after the gathering of the wheat, behold, the mow, the tares are bound in bundles, and the field remain with the good part. In other words, just like you have to wait until you can tell what's a tare and what's a piece of wheat, what's our role in coming down here and allowing the wicked to do what they do? They have to become the wicked and become the righteous. It's not about announcing that you get an A or announcing that you're celestial. It's about becoming the celestial. Your hand's been up for a while, so I want you to say what you want to say. I'm sorry. Yeah, Stuart.
Hey. I was just going to say, without the opposition, this is the faith thing, without opposition in the world, those who will be faithful would never go through the experiences they need to make their faith strong. That's kind of a refiner's fire principle. The Lord has sent us down for experiences to refine us, and that involves pain, that involves suffering. And so there has to be those things.
Yeah, not just for us to make our love. To refine us, but to separate us. Back up to verse 5, okay? And take a look at that. And Stuart, can you read verse 5 for me?
Behold, what we have been to do. The angels are crying unto the Lord day and night, who are ready and waiting to be sent forth to reap down the fields.
Okay, so he actually says, what you are doing right now is setting up this time when the angels will come and reap the fields. Now, consider this statement in the Doctrine and Covenants, where the Lord says the angels are waiting, with this statement from President Woodruff. This was given years and years later, in 1894. He says this, God has held the angels of destruction for many years, lest they should reap down the wheat with tares. But I want to tell you now that those angels have left the portals of heaven, and they stand over this people and this nation now, and are hovering over the earth, waiting to pour out the judgments. And from this very day they shall be poured out. Calamities and troubles are increasing in the earth, and there is a meaning to these things. Remember this and reflect upon these matters. If you do your duty, and I do my duty, we will have protection and shall pass through the afflictions in peace and safety. So section 86 says they're waiting. What did President Woodruff add to this revelation? They're gone, okay? The separation or the gathering and separating has already occurred. If you want a closer witness to our own time, this is from President Benson, he says this: there is a real sifting going on in the church, and it's going to become more pronounced with the passing of time. It will sift the wheat from the tares, because we face some difficult days, the likes of which we've never experienced in our lives, and those days are going to require faith and testimony and family unity, the likes of which we have never had. In other words, this parable was in future when section 86 was given. Is it in the future now? It's present history now. And that leads us perfectly to the next section. Turn to section 87 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Section 87 is properly called the Prophecy on War. Okay? It's kind of about all the problems that are going to happen before the Second Coming. Take a look in the section heading, and what day was section 87 of the Doctrine and Covenants received?
Christmas.
So, Merry Christmas. Here's a revelation on war. Hooray! And everything like that. Well, this section is not only a prophecy on war, it's arguably the most well-known, at least outside the church, of Joseph Smith's prophecies that he made. So that brings us to our last question. What's the difference between a prophecy and a prediction? So I'm going to throw that at you guys. What's the difference between something being a prophecy and something being a prediction? Go ahead.
Prophecy is revelation directly from God that is going to happen no matter what. Because God has said in other scriptures that what he has said, he has said. He doesn't like revoke it. It will all be fulfilled.
Well, I need to correct you real fast. Does God sometimes rescind prophecies?
Yeah.
I know we've seen a good example of that today. In section 85, the Lord issues a prophecy, but then the circumstances cleared up and the prophecy didn't happen. That does occasionally happen.
Okay.
But you're on the right track. Go ahead.
What you're talking about, that's a case of a condition, right? So God will reveal things to us with conditions. If we don't do certain things, we suffer consequences. So it's not that the prophecy didn't come true, rather that it was fulfilled in one of the two conditions, right?
Yeah, and sometimes prophecies are fulfilled in surprising ways.
Right.
Right. Go ahead, Melanie.
To me, like a prediction, it's sort of, I mean, in most cases, it's kind of like a logical assumption, kind of. I mean, if you're looking at the weather, then you're taking data and then like using it to make it kind of a logical prediction. There are things like fortune telling is not really real, that's not really kind of predicting, but a prophecy is something that like makes sense to Heavenly Father, but may not make sense to us yet. I don't know how to explain it, but that's
good. And I like what you said. Go ahead, Kurt.
I think a person that receives prophecy, they receive it because they have authority to be able to do so. And for me, like, I think this is going to happen, like the Lakers are going to. But like,
I prophesy that the Lakers shall win. I can see you outside the Delta Center, like in robes.
Prophecy is such a divine thing given to an authorized servant of God, for example, like Joseph Smith, that not only encompasses something so small like the Lakers game, but maybe it's like, well, the Lakers are going to take the NBA championships. It's like, to the future, just like in this revelation.
Okay, go ahead.
I think that the prophecies that we have will be more something that we can see happening if we're looking at things through spiritual eyes. There's a lot of prophecies about the signs of the second coming, where we're told, you know, the righteous will be waiting for these signs, and they'll be waiting for the second coming, I think. But the righteous will understand the prophecies better and say, oh, yeah, because of this and this, I think that prophecy is going to come true because we're understanding it spiritually. Whereas prediction is something that's more based on just, you know, physical evidence.
Okay. A prediction, sorry Jeff, is an extrapolation of data. A prophecy comes from God. In fact, it says in the scriptures the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It comes from the Savior, right? So let's look at the background of this. And some people, by the way, have criticized Joseph Smith saying this is a prediction. This is a prediction. He just sort of saw the data and predicted it. Okay, here's some background. The closest newspaper to Kirtland when this revelation is received is the Painesville Telegraph. And Joseph Smith in the history of the church has basically, we think, read the Painesville Telegraph because a lot of the language he uses here is similar to what appeared in that paper. In the history of the church, he writes, this is background. Appearances of troubles among the nations became more visible in this season than they had previously done, since the church began her journey out of the wilderness, and then this prophecy, okay? One of the other backgrounds is what was going on at this point in time was what's called a nullification crisis in South Carolina. What basically happened is South Carolina is this little state that's sort of argumentative and troublesome. Is anyone here from South Carolina? Okay, good. They're a bunch of troublemakers, and they cause a lot of problems. And at this time, Andrew Jackson's the president. South Carolina basically disagreed with a bunch of tariffs that the federal government passed, a bunch of laws. And so when Joseph Smith receives this prophecy, South Carolina was basically saying, look, we don't want to be part of the Union. We're not going to deal with your laws. And they were even mustering militia. And Andrew Jackson, the president, was getting ready to send the army down. And it looked like there was going to be civil war. Now look in section 87 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Where does Joseph Smith say the troubles are going to begin? South Carolina, right? So does this sound like a prophecy or prediction at this point? You could argue that Joseph Smith was just reading the paper and saying, hey, there's going to be troubles that's going to start in South Carolina. The problem is this. The crisis resolves itself, and the Union, the states, becomes stable again. Now turn to section 130 of the Doctrine and Covenants, okay? Section 130 is where Joseph Smith repeats this again, but now under much, much different circumstances. In 1832, when Section 87 was given, it really did look like there was going to be a civil war, and it was going to happen in South Carolina. This is much later. In fact, take a look in the section heading. What year is Section 130 doing?
1843.
Yeah, this is 1843, okay? So this is over a decade later. Joseph Smith is doing basically a Q&A session in Ramis, Illinois, and they start asking him questions, and look at what he says. Scroll down a little bit and go to verses 12 and 13. I prophesy in the name of the Lord God that the commencement of the difficulties which shall cause much bloodshed previous to the coming of the Son of Man will be in South Carolina. It may probably arise from the slave question. This is what he declared to me while I was praying earnestly on the subject, December 25th, 1832. So now everything's stable. Does Joseph Smith give up and say, well, my prediction was wrong? Instead, he doubles down and says, no, I know that it looks like nothing's going to happen, but I'm telling you, that was a prophecy. It is going to happen. And now let's take a look, flip back to section 87, at how accurate he was. Because some of this prophecy might yet need to be fulfilled. For example, first one, there's going to be a war, and it's going to start at the beginning of South Carolina, which will eventually terminate in the death and misery of many souls. Has this happened or no?
Yeah.
Civil War starts in 1860, and where is the very first shot fired? Fort Sumter, South Carolina. Of all the wars in American history, which is the bloodiest and the most severe?
Civil War,
because everybody that gets killed is an American. You could add together all the casualties and all the other wars that would equal the Civil War. Then he goes on and says this. The time shall come that war shall be poured out upon all nations, beginning at this place. So this is the first of the millennial wars, the wars leading up to the advent of Christ. He adds this part of it. For behold, the southern states shall be divided against the northern states, and the southern states will call on other nations, even the nation of Great Britain. Did this happen?
Yes.
The South tried to get Great Britain to intervene on their part so that they would have some sort of support to win the war, because the North, numerically, way outnumbered the South. But now take a look at this next part of the prophecy. This is where we get into futurity. It says this, they shall also call upon other nations, ruling the federal government against other nations, and war shall be poured out upon all nations. Now there's two ways to interpret this. Who's the they that says they shall call upon other nations?
The southern states.
It could be the southern states. And they did call upon other nations. They sent envoys to France and a bunch of European nations. What's another possible interpretation for who the they could be? It could be Great Britain. In other words, the prophecy, and I don't know whether or not this is the case, could be saying, and there's going to come a time when Great Britain is going to have to call upon other nations, and all nations shall be engaged in war. If that is true, have we seen this part of the prophecy fulfilled? Yeah, World War I, World War II. For better or worse, the world has been in a continuous state of warfare and battle since the Civil War happened. Not that it was that great before, but this really raise the energy for wars and how they were fought. The type of tactics they used in the Civil War could just mow people down. And those were carried into World War I and World War II, and even up until the wars that we see today. Now let's take a look at the next part of the prophecy, verses 4 and 5. It shall come to pass after many days, slaves shall rise up against their masters and shall be marshaled and disciplined for war. And it shall come to pass also that the remnants who are left of the land will marshal themselves and shall become exceedingly angry and shall vex the Gentiles with a sword. Can we think of a way that this prophecy, or part of the prophecy, is fulfilled? I'm really leading you by putting a picture up on the screen. Did we have slaves rise up in the Civil War? hundreds of thousands of slaves joined the Union Army and fought. But is this the only possible interpretation? Can you think of a situation where slaves have risen up to fought against their masters? Go ahead.
In Haiti, their rebellion against the French.
Yeah. Good. Anybody else? Yeah.
There were a lot of serfs in Russia right before the overthrew, and, you know, back in 1917, 1915, that happened. They overthrew the Russian government, the king.
The Bolshevik Revolution, yeah. Right? This is part of the prophecy where we can sit down and say, yeah, this is sad, scary stuff, but there's also some good stuff in there. The Lord's saying slavery, which up to this point was an assumption of human relations, that people just owned other people, would sort of start to wane. In fact, there's some other ways that this might be interpreted. If we talk about the fall of communism, or what's this a picture of right up here in the corner? This is a revolt that happened in China, in Tiananmen Square. A couple thousand students camped out in the square and protested because they thought the Chinese government was, well, frankly, oppressive. Well, after about a month, the army was sent in, and this one guy went and stood in front of a row of tanks and stopped them from coming in. In fact, if you can see the whole picture, there's about 15 tanks lined up behind him. Is this a possible fulfillment? Yeah, even 2 years ago, when they had what was called the Arab Spring in Egypt, I was looking at it and wondering, is this Section 87 still happening? Well, I can't answer for myself. No one can answer unless they're a prophet, how this is being fulfilled exactly. But we do know that the last two verses relate strictly to us. So now go to Section 87. Look at the very last two verses. Let's see here. Leanna, would you read those last two verses for me?
But the cry of the saints and of the blood of the saints shall cease to come up into the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth from the earth to be avenged of their enemies. Wherefore, stand ye in holy places and be not moved until the day of the Lord come. For behold, it cometh quickly, saith the Lord. Amen.
Now I know Sabaoth, which looks like Sabbath, that's actually a term that relates to warfare, like the God of war, Christ's role kind of as a warrior leader. But looking at those two verses, answer me this question. And all the tumult and the problems that are going to happen prior to the second coming, are the saints going to be kept physically safe from all those dangerous things? What phrase makes you think that that might not be the case? The blood of the saints. How old were you guys when the whole September 11th thing happened? So like 10? We're really young, okay? And I can imagine it being really scary. I remember the Sunday after that happened, I went to church, and my wife and I are sitting there, and our bishop, bless his heart, he's a great man, got up and said, "We've seen some amazing things this week. I am happy to report that no members of the church were in the Pentagon or the World Trade Center. All of them were absent that day." And everybody was like, "Oh, wow, that's neat. Did that turn out to be true?" There were members of the church then. There was a little guy in the Pentagon who was a return missionary, gone to BYU, and was right in the middle of the plane that was killed. He doesn't say that the saints are kept physically safe from these dangers, but what kind of safety does he guarantee? Yeah, stand ye in, what's the word? Holy places. There's no guarantee of physical safety, but there is a guarantee of spiritual safety. The day after 9/11 happened, President Hinckley went to Larry King, and he issued a statement that he repeated a little bit after General Conference. I don't know how many of you are old enough to remember this, but a month after 9/11, President Hinckley got up and was speaking in General Conference when suddenly he announced that the United States had begun to invade Afghanistan. In that talk, he said this: "Let us be prayerful. Let us pray for righteousness. Let us pray for the forces of good. Let us reach out to help men and women of goodwill. Whatever their religious persuasion or wherever they live, let us stand firm against evil, both at home and abroad. Let us live worthy of the blessings of heaven, performing our lives where necessary, and looking to Him to follow us all." He said, "Be still and know that I am God." Are these perilous times? They are. But there is no need to fear. We can have peace in our hearts and peace in our homes. We can be an influence for good in this world, every one of us. Peace, but not necessarily world peace. I bear my testimony to you that if you live the gospel in such a way that you know you're aligned with the Lord's wishes, you will have peace. That doesn't mean that everything in the world is going to solve itself. It's never been supposed to work that way. But you will have peace.